In the 1960s, Michael Herr was a young correspondent covering the war in Vietnam. 10 years later, he published his experiences in a book called Dispatches. This autumn, the book is re-released to mark both the 25th anniversary of its original publication and also to celebrate the 30th anniversary of its publisher, Picador. Now, BBC Radio 4 marks this double anniversary as David Soule reads from Michael Herr's Dispatches.
There was a map of Vietnam on the wall of my apartment in Saigon. And some nights, coming back late to the city, I'd lie out on my bed and look at it, too tired to do anything more than just get my boots off. That map was a marvel, especially now that it wasn't real anymore. It was very old. The paper had buckled in its frame after years in the wet Saigon heat, laying a kind of veil over the countries it depicted. Vietnam was divided into its older territories, into the west, past Laos and Cambodge, sat Siam, a kingdom. If dead ground could come back and haunt you the way dead people do, they'd have been able to mark my map current and burn the ones they'd been using since 64. It was late 67 now. Even the most detailed maps didn't reveal much anymore. Reading them was like trying to read the faces of the Vietnamese. And that was like trying to read the wind. We knew that the uses of most information were flexible. Different pieces of ground told different stories to different people. We also knew that for years now there'd been no country here but the war. The mission was always telling us about Viet Cong units being engaged and wiped out and then reappearing a month later in full strength. There was nothing very spooky about that. But when we went up against his terrain, we usually took it, definitively. And even if we didn't keep it, you could always see that we'd at least been there. At the end of my first week, I met an information officer who showed me on his map, and then from his chopper, what they'd done to the Hobo Woods, the vanished Hobo Woods, taken off by giant Rome plows and chemicals and long, slow fire, wasting hundreds of acres of cultivated and wild forest alike, denying the enemy valuable resources and cover. It had been part of his job for nearly a year now to tell people about that operation. Correspondents, touring congressmen, movie stars, staff officers from half the armies in the world. And he still couldn't get over it. It seemed to be keeping him young. It really showed what you could do if you had the know-how and the hardware. And if in the months following that operation, incidences of enemy activity in the area had increased significantly, and American losses had doubled and then doubled again, none of it was happening in any damn Hobo Woods. You'd better believe it. Going out at night, the medics gave you pills. Dexedrine breath like dead snakes kept too long in a jar. I never saw the need for them myself. A little contact or anything that even sounded like contact would give me more speed than I could bear. Whenever I heard something outside of our clenched little circle, I'd practically flip. A couple of rounds fired off in the dark a kilometer away, and the elephant would be there kneeling on my chest, sending me down into my boots for a breath. Once I thought I saw a light moving in the jungle, and I caught myself just under a whisper saying, "I'm not ready for this." That's when I decided to drop it and do something else with my nights. And I wasn't going out like the night ambushes did, or the LERPs, long-range reconnaissance patrollers, who did it night after night for weeks and months, creeping up on Viet Cong base camps or around moving columns of North Vietnamese. Anyway, I'd save the pills for later, for Saigon, and the awful depressions I always had there. I knew one 4th Division LERP who took his pills by the fistful, downs from the left pocket of his tiger suit and ups from the right, one to cut the trail for him and the others to send him down it. He told me they cooled things out just right for him, that he could see that old jungle at night like he was looking at it through a starlight scope. "They sure give you range," he said. This was his third tour. In 1965, he'd been the only survivor in a platoon of cavalry wiped out going into the Yadrung Valley. In 66, he'd come back with the special forces, and one morning after an ambush, he'd hidden under the bodies of his team, while the VC walked all around them with knives, making sure. They stripped the bodies of their gear, the berets too, and finally went away laughing. After that, there was nothing left for him in the war except the Lerps. "I just can't hack it back in the world," he'd said. He told me that after he'd come back home the last time, he would sit in his room all day, and sometimes he'd stick a hunting rifle out the window, leading people and cars as they passed his house until the only feeling he was aware of was all up in the tip of that one finger. "It used to put my folks real uptight," he said. "But he put people uptight here, even here." "No, man, I'm sorry. He's just too crazy for me," one team said. "All you gotta do is eyes. That's the whole story right there. You do it quick. I mean, you don't want to let him catch you at it." But he always seemed to be watching for it. I think he slept with his eyes open, and I was afraid of him anyway. All I ever managed was one quick look in, and that was like looking at the floor of an ocean. He wore a gold earring and a headband torn from a piece of camouflage parachute material, and since nobody was about to tell him to get his hair cut, it fell below his shoulders, covering a thick purple scar. Even at division, he never went anywhere without a .45 and a knife, and he thought I was a freak because I couldn't carry a weapon. "Didn't you ever meet a reporter before?" I asked him. "Tits on a bull," he said. "Nothing personal. But what a story you told me. As one pointed and resonant as any war story I ever heard. It took me a year to understand it. Patrol went up the mountain. One man came back. He died before he could tell us what happened. I waited for the rest, but it seemed not to be that kind of story. When I asked him what had happened, he just looked like he felt sorry for me. Damned if he'd waste his time telling stories to anyone dumb as I was. His face was all painted up for night walking now, like a bad hallucination. Not like the painted faces I'd seen in San Francisco only a few weeks before, the extreme of the same zeal. I never spoke to him again, but I saw him. When they came back in the next morning, he had a prisoner with him, blindfolded and with his elbows bound sharply behind him. The Lerp area would definitely be off limits during the interrogation, and anyway, I was already down at the strip waiting for a helicopter to come and take me out of there.
"Hey, what are you guys with?" "Oh, we thought you was with the United Services Organization. Your hair's so long." Page took the kid's picture. I got the words down, and Flynn laughed and told him we were the Rolling Stones. The three of us traveled around together for about a month that summer. At one landing zone, the brigade chopper came in with a real foxtail hanging off the aerial. When the commander walked by us, he almost had a heart attack. "Don't you men salute officers?" "We're not men," Page said. "We're correspondents." When the commander heard that, he wanted to throw a spontaneous operation for us, crank up his whole brigade and get some people killed. We had to get out on the next chopper to keep him from going ahead with it. Amazing what some of them would do for a little ink. Page was an English photographer. He'd augment his field gear with freak paraphernalia, scarves and beads. Guys would stare at him like he'd just come down off a wall on Mars. Sean Flynn could look more incredibly beautiful than even his father Errol had 30 years before as Captain Blood. We packed grass and tape. "Have you seen your mother baby standing in the shadows?" "Best of the animals, purple haze." Once in a while, we'd catch a chopper straight into one of the lower hells, but it was a quiet time in the war. Mostly it was landing zones and camps, grunts hanging around, faces, stories. "Best ways to just keep moving," one of them told us. "Just stay in motion, you know what I'm saying?" We knew. He was a moving target survivor subscriber, a true child of the war. Because except for the rare times when you were pinned or stranded, the system was geared to keep you mobile. As a technique for staying alive, it seemed to make as much sense as anything, given naturally that you were there to begin with and wanted to see it close. But the more you moved, the more you saw. The more you saw, the more besides death and mutilation you risked.
And the more you risked of that, the more you would have to let go of one day as a survivor. Some of us moved around the war like crazy people until we couldn't see which way the run was taking us anymore. As long as we could have choppers like taxis, it took real exhaustion or depression or a dozen pipes of opium to keep us even apparently quiet. We'd still be running around inside our skins like something was after us. In the months after I got back, the hundreds of helicopters I'd flown in began to draw together until they formed a collective meta-chopper. And in my mind, it was the sexiest thing going. Saver, destroyer, provider, waster, fluent, canny and human, hot steel, grease, jungle-saturated canvas webbing, cassette rock and roll in one ear, and door gun fire in the other. Vitality and death, death itself, hardly an intruder. Men on the cruise would say that once you'd carry the dead person, he would always be there, riding with you. Sometimes the chopper you were riding in would top a hill, and all the ground in front of you as far as the next hill would be charred and pitted and still smoking, and something between your chest and your stomach would turn over. Frail gray smoke where they'd burn off the rice fields around a free strike zone. Brilliant white smoke from phosphorus. Deep black smoke from palm. They'd said that if you stood at the base of a column of napalm smoke, it would suck the air right out of your lungs. Once we fanned over a little ville that had just been airstruck, and the words of a song by Wingy Minone that I had heard when I was a few years old snapped into my head. Stop the war, these cats is killing themselves. Then we dropped, hovered, settled down into purple landing zone smoke. Dozens of children broke from their hooches to run in toward the focus of our landing, the pilot laughing and saying, Vietnam, man, bomb 'em and feed 'em. Bomb 'em and feed 'em. Air mobility, dig it. You weren't going anywhere. It made you feel safe, but it was only a stunt. Mobility was just mobility. It saved lives or took them all the time. The ground was always in play, always being swept. Under the ground was his. Above it was ours. We had the air. We could get up in it, but not disappear into it. We could run, but we couldn't hide. And he could do each so well that sometimes it looked like he was doing them both at once. All the same, one place or another, it was always going on. Rock around the clock. We had the days, and he had the nights. You could be in the most protected space in Vietnam and still know that your safety was provisional, that early death, blindness, loss of legs, arms, or balls could come in on the freaky fluky as easily as in the so-called expected ways. You heard so many stories, it was a wonder anyone was left alive to die. The roads were mined, the trails booby-trapped, satchel charges and grenades blew up jeeps and movie theaters. The VC got work inside all the camps, the shoeshine boys and laundresses. They'd start your fatigues and burn your shit and then go home and mortar your area. Saigon and Da Nang held such hostile vibes that you felt you were being dry-sniped every time someone looked at you, and choppers fell out of the sky like fat, poisoned birds 100 times a day. After a while, I couldn't get on one without thinking that I must be out of my goddamn mind.
David Soule is reading from Michael Herr's Dispatches. The program was abridged and produced for Radio 4 by Jane Marshall Productions. Part 2 is tomorrow. David Soule takes us back to the 1960s and the Vietnam War as he continues to read Michael Herr's Dispatches. Herr was a young writer working for Esquire magazine who decided he should go and see for himself what his fellow Americans were facing in a war being fought on the other side of the world.
You know how it is. You want to look and you don't want to look. I can remember the strange feelings I had when I was a kid looking at war photographs in life. The ones that show dead people lying close together in a field or a street, often touching, seeming to hold each other. Even when the picture was sharply defined, something wasn't clear at all. I remember now the shame I felt looking at the pictures, like looking at porn. I could have looked all day, and I still wouldn't have accepted the connection between a detached leg and the rest of the body. Supposedly, you weren't going to have that kind of obscuration when you finally started seeing them on real ground in front of you. But you tended to manufacture it anyway because of how often and how badly you needed protection from what you were seeing. Had actually come 30,000 miles to see. Once I looked at them strung from the perimeter to the tree line, most of them clumped together nearest the wire, then fanning out towards the tree line. Close, the captain said. Then a few of his men went out there. I heard an M16 on full automatic starting to go through clips, a second to fire, three to plug in a fresh clip, and I saw a man out there doing it. Every round was like a tiny concentration of high-velocity wind, making the bodies wince and shiver. When he finished, he walked by us on the way back to his hooch, and I knew I hadn't seen anything until I saw his face. It was flushed and mottled and twisted, like he had his face skin on inside out. Really a dude who'd shot his wad. The captain wasn't too pleased about my having seen that. As though I could say anything honest about it except blah, 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 cover the war. Maybe we accepted each other's stories about why we were there at face value. The grunts who had to be there, the spooks and civilians whose corporate faith had led them there, the correspondents whose curiosity or ambition drew them there. Not that you didn't hear some overripe bullshit about it, hearts and minds, peoples of the Republic, maintaining the equilibrium of the ding-dong by containing the ever-encroaching doodah. You could also hear the other, some young soldier, speaking in all bloody innocence, saying, "All that's just a load, man. We're here to kill gooks, period." Which wasn't at all true of me. I was there to watch. Talk about irony. I went to cover the war, and the war covered me. An old story, unless, of course, you've never heard it. I went there behind the crude but serious belief that you had to be able to look at anything. Serious because I acted on it and went. Crude because I didn't know it took the war to teach it. That you were as responsible for everything you saw as you were for everything you did. The problem was that you didn't always know what you were seeing until later. Maybe years later. That a lot of it never made it in at all. It just stayed stored there in your eyes. Time and information, rock and roll, life itself. The information isn't frozen. You are. In war, more than another life, you don't really know what you're doing most of the time. You're just behaving. And afterwards, you can make up any kind of bullshit you want. Say you felt good or bad, loved it or hated it, did the right thing or the wrong thing. Still, what happened, happened. Coming back, telling stories, I'd say, "Oh man, I was scared. And oh God, I thought it was all over." A long time before I knew how scared I really was supposed to be, or how much beyond my control all over could become. I wasn't dumb, but I sure was raw. Certain connections are hard to make when you come from a place where they go around with war in their heads all the time. "Time is on my side" was already written across the first helmet I ever wore there. And underneath it, in smaller lettering that read more like a whispered prayer, "No lie, G.I." The rear hatch gunner on a Chinook threw it to me that first morning of the Khantoum airstrip. A few hours after the dock tow fighting had ended, screaming at me through the rotor wind, "You keep that! We got plenty! Good luck!" I was so glad to have the equipment, I didn't stop to think where it had to come from. The sweatband inside was black and greasy. It was more alive now than the man who'd worn it. When I got rid of it 10 minutes later, I didn't just leave it on the ground. I snuck away from it, furtive and ashamed. That morning, they sent me down the line from a colonel to a major to a captain to a sergeant, who took one look, called me fresh meat and told me to go find some other outfit to get myself killed with. I laughed and told him nothing was going to happen to me. He gave my shoulder a tender, menacing pat and said, "This ain't the goddamn movies over here, you know." Day one, if anything could have penetrated that first innocence, I might have taken the next plane out. It was like a walk through a colony of stroke victims. 1,000 men on a cold, rainy airfield after too much of something I'd never really know. Dirt and blood and torn fatigues, eyes that poured out a steady charge of wasted horror. I just missed the biggest battle of the war so far. I was telling myself that I was sorry, but it was right there all around me, and I didn't even know it. I couldn't look at anyone for more than a second. I didn't want to be caught listening. I didn't know what to say or do. I didn't like it already. I turned to walk some other way, and there was a man standing in front of me. He didn't exactly block me, but he didn't move either. He tottered a little and blinked. He looked at me and through me. No one had ever looked at me like that before. I felt a cold, fat drop of sweat start down the middle of my back like a spider. The man lit a cigarette and then sort of slobbered it out. He tried again with a fresh cigarette. I gave him a light. There was a flicker of acknowledgement, but after a few puffs, it went out too, and he let it drop to the ground. "I couldn't spit for a week up there," he said. "Now I can't stop." When the 173rd held services for their dead from Dak To, the boots of the dead men were arranged in formation on the ground. It was an old paratrooper tradition, but knowing that didn't reduce it or make it any less spooky. A company's worth of jump boots standing empty in the dust, taking benediction, while the real substance of the ceremony was being bagged and tagged and shipped back home. Dak To itself had only been the command point for a combat without focus that tore a 30-mile arc over the hills running northeast to southwest of a small base. "Just like going in against the Japs," one kid called it. "The heaviest fighting in Vietnam since the Yadrung Valley 2 years before. And one of the only times after Yadrung when ground fire was so intense that the medevacs couldn't land through it. Wounded backed up for hours and sometimes days, and a lot of men died who might have been saved. Resupply couldn't make it in either, and the early worry about running out of ammunition grew into a panic and beyond. It became real. At the worst, a battalion of airborne assaulting Hill 875 got caught in an ambush sprung from behind where no North Vietnamese had been reported, and its three companies were pinned and cut off in the raking fire of that trap for 2 days. Afterwards, when a correspondent asked one of the survivors what had happened, he was told, "What the hell do you think happened? We got shot to pieces." The correspondent started to write that down, and the paratrooper said, "Make that little pieces." The ground action had been over for nearly 24 hours now, but it was still going on in compulsive replay among the men who'd been there. A dead body is some tough shit, but bringing your own ass out alive can sure help you get over it. "We had this lieutenant, honest to Christ. He was about the biggest dipshit fool of all time. We called him Lieutenant Gladly because he was always going, 'Men, men, I won't never ask you to do nothing I wouldn't do myself gladly.' What an asshole. We was on 1338 and he goes to me, 'Take a little run up the ridge and report to me.' And I goes like, 'Never happened, sir.' So he goes up there himself and damned if the asshole doesn't get zapped. He said we was going to have a real serious talk when he come back too. Sorry about that." Everywhere you went, people said, "Well, I hope you get a story." And everywhere you went, you did. Some journalists talked about no-story operations, but I never went on one. Those were the same journalists who'd asked what the hell we ever found to talk to grunts about, who said they never heard a grunt talk about anything except cars and football. But they all had a story, and in the war, they were all driven to tell it. We was getting killed, and the dinks was panicking. And when the choppers came in to get us out, there wasn't enough room for everybody. The dinks was screaming and carrying on, grabbing hold of the treads and grabbing hold of our legs till we couldn't get the choppers up. So we just said, "Smack it." let these people get their own bloody choppers. And we started shooting them. And even then they kept coming. Oh, man, it was wild.
That was a story from the Ashaw Valley. Years before my time there, an old story with the hair still growing on it. Sometimes the stories were so fresh that the teller was in shock. Sometimes they were long and complex. Sometimes the whole thing was contained in a few words on a helmet. The mix was amazing. Incipient saints and realized homicidals. Unconscious lyric poets and mean dumb assholes with their brains all down in their necks. And even though by the time I left, I knew where all the stories came from and where they were going, I was never bored. Obviously, what they really wanted to tell you was how tired they were and how sick of it, how moved they'd been and how afraid. But maybe that was me. By then, my posture was shot. Reporter. Must be pretty hard to stay detached, a man on the plane to San Francisco said, and I said, impossible. Cover the war, what a gig to frame for yourself. Going out after one kind of information and getting another, totally other. To lock your eyes open, drop your blood temperature down under zero. We had this gook and we was gonna skin him, a grunt told me. I mean, he was already dead and everything. And the lieutenant comes over and says, hey, asshole, there's a reporter over there. You want him to come out and see that? Was it possible that they were there and not haunted? No, not a chance. I stood as close to them as I could without actually being one of them, and then I stood as far back as I could without leaving the planet. Disgust doesn't begin to describe what they made me feel. They threw people out of helicopters, tied people up, and put dogs on them. Brutality was just a word in my mouth before that. But disgust was only one color in the whole mandala. Gentleness and pity were other colors. There wasn't a color left out. I think that those people who used to say they only wept for the Vietnamese never really wept for anyone at all. If they couldn't squeeze out at least one for these men and boys when they died or had their lives cracked open for them. After a year, I felt so plugged into all the stories and the images and the fear that even the dead started telling me stories. You'd hear them out of a remote but accessible space where there were no ideas, no emotions, no proper language, only clean information. However many times it happened, whether I'd known them or not, no matter what I'd felt about them or the way they died, their story was always there and it was always the same. It went, put yourself in my place.
David Soul has been reading from Michael Herr's Dispatches. The program was abridged and produced for Radio 4 by Jane Marshall Productions. Now on Radio 4 FM, Book of the Week, and David Soul continues to read Dispatches, the memoirs of the correspondent Michael Herr, who covered the Vietnam War in the 1960s.
In Saigon, I always went to sleep stoned, so I almost always lost my dreams, probably just as well. Sock in deep under that information and get whatever rest you could. I'd watched grunts asleep putting out the rapid eye movements like a firefight in the dark. Their dreaming would be constant, violent, and clear, like a man in the Pleiku hospital on the night I was there. It was 3 a.m, scary and upsetting, like hearing a language for the first time and somehow understanding every word, the voice loud and small at the same time, insistent, calling, who's in the next room? There was a single shaded light over the desk at the end of the ward where I sat with the orderly. I could only see the first few beds. It felt like there were 1,000 of them running out into the darkness, but actually there were only 20 in each row. After the man had repeated it a few times, there was a change, like the break in a fever. He sounded like a pleading little boy. I could see cigarettes being lighted at the far end of the ward, mumbles and groans, wounded men returning to consciousness, pain. But the man who'd been dreaming slept through it. As for my own dreams, the ones I lost out there would make it through later. I should have known. Some things will just naturally follow until they take. The night would come when they'd be vivid and unremitting.
That night, the beginning of a long string.
Saigon blues. A bitch. Nothing for it but some smoke and a little lie down. Waking in the late afternoon on damp pillows, feeling the emptiness of the bed behind you as you walk to the window. Or just lying there, tracking the rotations of a ceiling fan, reaching for the fat roach that sat on my cigarette lighter in a yellow disc of grass tar. There were mornings when I'd do it before my feet even hit the floor. Dear Mom, stoned again. In Saigon and Da Nang, we'd get stoned together and keep the common pool stocked and tended. It was bottomless and alive with lerps, green beret bushmasters, redundant mutilators, widow makers, name takers, classic essential American types, like they were programmed in their genes to do it. The first taste made them crazy for it, just like they knew it would. You thought you were separate and protected. You could travel the war for 100 years. A swim in that pool could still be worth a piece of your balance. We'd all heard about the man in the highlands who was building his own gook. Parts were the least of his troubles. In Chu Lai, some Marines pointed a man out to me and swore to God they'd seen him bayonet a wounded North Vietnamese and then lick the bayonet clean. There was a famous story. Some reporters asked a door gunner, "How can you shoot women and children?" And he'd answered, "Well, it's easy. You just don't lead them so much." Well, they said you needed a sense of humor. There you go. Even the VC had one. Once after an ambush that killed a lot of Americans, they covered the fields with copies of a photograph that showed one more young dead American with a punchline on the back, "Your x-rays have just come back from the lab, and we think we know what your problem is." 5 to 7 were bleary low hours in Saigon, the city's energy ebbing at dusk until it got dark and movement was replaced with apprehension. Saigon at night was still Vietnam at night. Night was the war's truest medium. Maybe you had to be pathological to find glamour in Saigon. Maybe you just had to settle for very little. But Saigon had it for me, and danger activated it. The days of big, persistent terror in Saigon were over. But everyone felt they could come back again any time. Heavy. Like when they blew up the Mekong floating restaurant, waited for it to be rebuilt and moved it to another spot on the river, and then blew it up again. When they bombed the first U.S. embassy and changed the war forever from the intimate inside out. There were 4 known VC sapper battalions in the area, guerrilla superstars. They didn't even have to do anything to put the fear out. Empty ambulances sat parked at all hours in front of the new embassy. Guards ran mirrors under all vehicles entering all installations. There were checkpoints and wire, high-gauge grills at the windows, but they still got through once in a while. Random terror, but real. Saigon just before the Tet Offensive. Guess again. Those nights, there was a serious tiger lady going around on a Honda, shooting American officers on the street with a .45. I think she'd killed over a dozen in 3 months. The Saigon papers described her as beautiful, but I don't know how anybody knew that. The commander of one of the Saigon military police battalions said he thought it was a man dressed up because a .45 was an awful lot of gun for an itty-bitty Vietnamese woman. Saigon, the center, where every action in the bushes hundreds of miles away fed back into a town on a karmic wire strung so tight that if you touched it in the early morning, it would sing all day and all night. Nothing so terrible ever happened up country that it was beyond language fix and press relations. You'd either meet an optimism that no violence could unconvince or a cynicism that would eat itself empty every day. Those men, they talked as though killing a man was nothing more than depriving him of his vigor. In Saigon, it never mattered what they told you, even less when they actually seemed to believe it. Names of operations, of commanders, guesses, second guesses, you could let it all go. American and essentially adolescent, if that energy could have been channeled into anything more than noise, waste, and pain, it would have lighted up Indochina for 1,000 years. The mission and the motion, military arms and civilian arms, more combatant between themselves than together against the Kong. Gun arms, knife arms, pencil arms, creeping, peeping arms, information arms as tricky as the arms of Plastic Man.
At the bottom was the shit-faced grunt. At the top, a command trinity. A blue-eyed, hero-faced general. A geriatrics emergency ambassador. And a hale, heartless CIA performer. All through the middle were the Vietnam War and the Vietnamese. Not always exactly innocent bystanders. Probably no accident that we'd found each other. For the non-combatants stationed in Saigon, the war wasn't much more real than if they'd been getting it on TV back at Andrews. There was the common failure of feeling and imagination compounded by punishing boredom, an alienation beyond tolerance, and a terrible ongoing anxiety that it might one day, any day, come closer than it had so far. And operating inside of that fear was the half-hidden, half-vaunted jealousy of every grunt who ever went out there and killed himself a gook, furtive, vicarious, bloodthirsting behind 10,000 desks, a fantasy life rich with lurid war comics adventure. In the first week of December 1967, I turned on the radio and heard, "The Pentagon announced today that compared to Korea, the Vietnam War will be an economy war, provided that it does not exceed the Korean War in length, which means that it will have to end sometime in 1968. By the time that General Westmoreland came home that fall to cheerlead and request beg another quarter of a million men with his light at the end of the tunnel collateral, there were people leaning so far out to hear good news that a lot of them slipped over the edge and said that they could see it too. Outside of Tainan City, a man whose work kept him up to here in tunnels, lobbing grenades into them, popping CS smoke into them, crawling down them himself to bring the bad guys out dead or alive, he almost smiled when he heard that one and said, "What does this asshole know about tunnels?" A few months earlier, there'd been an attempt higher to crank up the Home for Christmas rumor. But it wouldn't take. The troop consensus was too strong. It went, "Never happen." Most commanders told you they thought they had it pretty well under control. "He's all pissed out, Charlie. Shot his whole wad." In Saigon, it would be restructured for briefings. "He no longer maintains, in our view, capability to mount, execute, or sustain a serious offensive action." But in the jungle, where they were deprived of all information except what they gathered to themselves, they'd look around like someone was watching and say, "I don't know. Charlie's up to something. Watch." That fall, all mission talked about was control. Arms control, information control, psychopolitical control, control of terrain. But when the talk had passed, the only thing left standing up that looked true was your sense of how out of control things really were. Year after year, season after season, using up options faster than rounds on a machine gun belt, we called it right and righteous, viable, and even almost won. And it still only went on the way it went on. When all the projections of intent and strategy twist and turn back on you, tracking team blood, sorry, just won't cover it. There's nothing so embarrassing as when things go wrong in a war. 500 officers were nailed to the bar. This is where you were asked, "Are you a dove or a hawk? Would you rather fight them here or in Pasadena?" One night I listened while a colonel explained the war in terms of protein. We were a nation of high-protein, meat-eating hunters, while the other guy just ate rice and a few grungy fish heads. We were going to club him to death with our meat. What could you say except, "Colonel, you're insane." It was like turning up in the middle of some black Looney Tune with a duck hat all the lines. "Come on," the captain said. "We'll take you out to play cowboys and Indians." We walked out from Song Bay in a long line, maybe 100 men. Rifles, heavy automatics, mortars. We played all morning until someone got something. A scout, they thought. They couldn't even tell for sure whether he was from a friendly tribe or not. The captain thought about it during the walk back. He put in the report, "One VC killed. Good for the unit," he said. The sponsor wasn't buying any dead civilians. Search and destroy, more a gestalt than a tactic, brought up alive and streaming from the command psyche. The VC had a similar tactic, called find and kill. Either way, it was us looking for him, looking for us, looking for him. War on a crackerjack box, repeated to diminishing returns. Whichever way it went, you were covering the war. Your choice of story told it all, and in Vietnam, an infatuation like that with violence wouldn't go unrequited for very long. It would come and put its wild mouth all over you. Between what contact did to you and how tired you got, between the far-out things you saw or heard, and what you personally lost out of all that got blown away, the war made a place for you that was all yours. Finding it was like listening to esoteric music. You didn't hear it in any essential way through all the repetitions until your own breath had entered it and become another instrument, and by then it wasn't just music anymore. It was experience. Life is movie, war as war movie, war as life. A complete process if you got to complete it. A distinct path to travel, but dark and hard, and not any easier if you knew that you'd put your own foot on it yourself, deliberately.
David Soule has been reading Michael Herr's Dispatches, which was abridged and produced for BBC Radio 4 by Jane Marshall Productions.
This is Radio 4 92 to 95 FM and Dispatches. David Soule continues to read from the memoirs of the war correspondent Michael Herr, who covered the Vietnam War in the 1960s.
During the first weeks of the Tet Offensive, the curfew began early in the afternoon and was strictly enforced. By 2:30 each day, Saigon was a desolate city, whose long avenues held nothing but refuse, small distinct piles of human excrement, and the dead flowers and spent firecracker casings of a Lunar New Year. Alive Saigon had been depressing enough, but during the offensive it became so stark that in an odd way it was invigorating. With so much filth growing in so many streets and alleys, an epidemic of plague was feared. And if there was ever a place that suggested plague, it was Saigon in the emergency. American civilians, engineers and construction workers who were making it here like they'd never made it at home, began forming into large armed bands carrying 45s and grease guns, and no mob of hysterical vigilantes ever promised more bad news. We took a huge collective nervous breakdown. Vietnam was a dark room full of deadly objects. The VC were everywhere all at once like spider cancer. And instead of losing the war in little pieces over years, we lost it fast in under a week. After that, we were like the characters in pop grunt mythology, dead but too dumb to lie down. Our worst dread of the yellow peril became realized. We saw them dying by the thousands all over the country. Yet they didn't seem depleted, let alone exhausted, as the mission was claiming. We took space back quickly, expensively, with total panic, and close to maximum brutality. Our machine was devastating and versatile. It could do everything but stop. The mission council joined hands and passed together through the looking glass. Our general was telling such incredible stories of triumph and victory that a few high-level Americans had to ask him to cool it. A British correspondent compared the mission posture to the captain of the Titanic announcing, "There's no cause for alarm. We're only stopping briefly to take on a little ice." By the time I got back to Saigon on the fourth day, a lot of information from around the country had settled, and it was bad. Even after you picked out the threads of rumor, like the one about the Caucasians, obviously Americans, fighting for the Viet Cong, or the one about thousands of North Vietnamese army executions in Hue. Almost as much as the grunts in the Vietnamese, Tet was pushing correspondents closer to the wall than they ever wanted to go. I realized later that however childish I might remain, actual youth had been pressed out of me in just the 3 days it took me to cross the 60 miles between Cam Tho and Saigon. In Saigon, I saw friends flipping out almost completely. A few left. Some took to their beds for days with the exhaustion of deep depression. I went the other way, hyper and agitated, until I was only doing 3 hours of sleep a night. A friend on the Times said he didn't mind his nightmares so much as the waking impulse to file on them. If we knew how rough it was going to get, we might have felt better. After a few days, the air routes opened up again, and we went up to Hue. Going in there were 60 of us packed into one of 8 trucks moving in convoy from Fubai, bringing in over 300 replacements for the casualties taken in the earliest fighting south of the Perfume River. There'd been a harsh, dark storm going on for days, and it turned the convoy route into a mudbed. It was terribly cold in the trucks, and the road was covered with leaves that had either been blown off the trees by the storm or torn away by our artillery. Many of the houses had been completely collapsed, and not one had been left without pitting from shell fragments. Hundreds of refugees held to the side of the road as we passed, many of them wounded. The kids would laugh and shout. The old would look on with that silent tolerance for misery that made so many Americans uneasy, but the young men and women would often look at us with unmistakable contempt. We sat there trying to keep it up for each other, grinning at the discomfort, sharing the first fear, glad we weren't riding point or closing the rear. They'd been hitting our trucks regularly. The houses we passed so slowly made good cover for snipers, and one B-40 rocket could have made casualties out of a whole truckload of us. All the grunts were whistling, and no two were whistling the same tune. It sounded like a locker room before a game nobody wanted to play. The bridge was down that spanned the canal, dividing the village of Anku and the southern sector of Wei. The forward area beyond wasn't thought to be secure, so we bivouacked in the village for the night. It had been completely deserted, and we set ourselves up in empty hooches, laying our poncho liners out over broken glass and shattered brick. At dusk, while we all stretched out along the canal bank eating dinner, 2 Marine gunships came down and began strafing us, and we ran for cover, more surprised than scared. "Way to pinpoint the goddamn enemy," one of the grunts said, and he set up his M60 machine gun in case they came back. "I don't guess we gotta take that shit," he said. In the morning, we crossed the canal and started walking in until we came across the first of the hundreds of civilian dead that we were to see in the next weeks. An old man arched over his straw hat, and a little girl who'd been hit while riding her bicycle, lying there with her arm up like a reproach. Along the Perfume River's south bank, there's a long, graceful park that separates Hue's most pleasant avenue from the riverfront. People will talk about how they'd sit out there in the sun and watch the sampans moving down the river. Many of the villas had been destroyed, and in the middle of a street, a couple of ambulances had been blown up. We were waiting for some decision on whether or not U.S. Marines would be going into the citadel itself, but no one had any doubts about what that decision would be. We sat there, taking in the dread by watching the columns of smoke across the river, receiving occasional sniper rounds. One Marine next to me was saying that it was just a damn shame. All them poor people, all them nice-looking houses. He was looking at the black napalm blasts and the wreckage along the wall. "Looks like the Imperial cities had the schnitz," he said. The North Vietnamese army had dug themselves so deeply into the wall that airstrikes had to open it meter by meter, dropping napalm as close as 100 meters from our positions. Up on the highest point of the wall, on what had once been a tower, I looked across the citadel's moat and saw the NVA moving quickly across the rubble of the opposing wall. We were close enough to be able to see their faces. A rifle went off a few feet to my right, and one of the running figures jerked back and dropped. A Marine sniper leaned out from his cover and grinned at me. We were only meters away from the worst of the fighting, and yet civilians kept appearing, smiling, shrugging, trying to get back to their homes. The Marines would try to menace them away at rifle point, and the refugees would smile, half bowing, and flit up one of the shattered streets. A little boy of about 10 came up to a bunch of Marines from Charlie Company. He was laughing and moving his head from side to side in a funny way. The fierceness in his eyes should have told everyone what it was, but it had never occurred to most of the grunts that a Vietnamese child could be driven mad too. And by the time they understood, the boy had begun to go for their eyes, spooking everyone. A black grunt grabbed him and held him. "Come on, poor little baby. For one of these grunts shoot you," he said, as he carried the boy away. On the worst days, no one expected to get through it alive. A despair set in among the members of the battalion that the older ones, the veterans of 2 other wars, had never seen before. Some of us got a chopper that took us and a dozen dead Marines to the base at Phu Bai. And 3 minutes after we landed, we caught a plane to Da Nang. The inside of the press center was freezing with air conditioning. I sat at a table and ordered a hamburger and a brandy. I sat there for a couple of hours and ordered 4 more hamburgers and at least a dozen brandies. It just wasn't possible to have been where we'd been before and to be where we were now all in the same afternoon. One of the correspondents who came back with me sat at another table, also by himself, and we looked at each other, shook our heads, and laughed. I went to my room and got into the shower. In bed, I smoked a joint. I was going back in the morning, it was understood. All of my stuff was in order, ready for the 5 o'clock wake up. I finished the joint and shut it off into sleep. By the end of the week, the wall had cost the Marines roughly 1 casualty for every meter taken. At night, the major commanding the battalion would sit reading his maps, staring vacantly at the trapezoid of the citadel. It could have been a scene in a Norman farmhouse 25 years ago. The major hadn't slept for 5 nights, and for the 5th night in a row, he assured us that tomorrow would get it for sure, the final stretch of the wall. And one of his aides, a tough Mustang first lieutenant, would pitch an ironic smile about the major's stare. It was like hearing him say, "The major here's full of shit, and we both know it." Sometimes a company would find itself completely cut off, and it would take hours for the Marines to get their wounded out. I remember one Marine with a head wound, who, when the GP was installed, finally jumped out and started to push, knowing it was the only way out of there. There was one Marine who'd been shot through the neck, and all the way out, the corpsman massaged his chest. By the time they reached the station, though, he was so bad that the doctor triaged him, passed him over to treat the ones he knew could still be saved. And when they put him into the green rubber body bag, there was some chance he was clinically alive. The doctor had never had to make choices like that before, and he wasn't getting used to it. During the lulls, he'd step outside for some air, but it was no better out there. In the station, there was the youngest-looking Marine I'd ever seen. He'd been caught in the knee by a large piece of shrapnel, and he'd no idea what they'd do with him now that he was wounded. He lay on the stretcher while the doctor explained how he'd be choppered back to Fubai Hospital and flown back to the States for what would certainly be the rest of his tour. At first, the boy was sure the doctor was kidding him, and then he started to believe it. He was actually getting out. He couldn't stop smiling, and enormous tears ran down into his ears. It was at this point that I began to recognize almost every casualty, remember conversations we'd had days or even hours earlier, and that's when I left, riding a medevac with a lieutenant who was covered with blood-soaked bandages. He'd been hit in both legs, both arms, the chest and head. His ears and eyes were full of caked blood, and he asked a photographer to get a picture of him like this to send to his wife. By now, the battle for Wei was almost over. The NVA flag that had flown for so long over the south wall had been cut down, and in its place, an American flag had been put up. 2 days later, the Vietnamese Rangers stormed through the walls of the Imperial Palace, but there were no NVA left inside. Except for a few bodies in the moat, most of their dead had been buried. There were 2 official ceremonies marking the expulsion of the NVA, both flag raisings. On the south bank of the Perfume River, 200 refugees were recruited to stand sullen and silent in the rain and watch the government of Vietnam flag being run up. But the rope snapped, and the crowd, thinking the Viet Cong had shot it down, broke up in panic. As for the other ceremony, the citadel was thought by most people to be insecure. And when the flag finally went up, there was no one to watch it except for a handful of Vietnamese troops.
David Soul has been reading Michael Hare's dispatches. The programme was abridged and produced for BBC Radio 4 by Jane Marshall Productions.
This is Radio 4 FM. And now Book of the Week, and David Soul reads the last extract from Michael Hare's dispatches as the war correspondent faces a new challenge, learning to live as a survivor.
The release graffiti on the walls at Tonson Nut Airport read, "I'm going home. I've seen a lot of Vietnam in 18 months. May Lord help this place. Daros, 10 September, 68. My fellow correspondents were seeing me off. Flynn gave me a kind of blessing. Don't piss it all away at cocktail parties. And Paige gave me a small ball of opium to eat on the flight back. Stoned dreaming through Honolulu, San Francisco, New York, and the hallucination of home. Opium space, a big round O, and time outside of time, a trip that happened in seconds and over years, Asian time, not clear whether Vietnam was behind me or somehow still ahead. Far as I'm concerned, this one's over the day I get home, a grunt had told us a few weeks before. Don't hold your breath, Dana said. Home. 28 years old, feeling like Rip Van Winkle, with a heart like one of those little paper pills they make in China. You drop them into water and they open out to form a flower or a pagoda. Mine opened out into war and loss. The war only had one way of taking your pain away quickly. It seemed now that everybody knew someone who'd been in Vietnam and didn't want to talk about it. Maybe they just didn't know how. People I'd meet would take it for granted that I was articulate, ask me if I minded, but usually the questions were political, square, innocent. They already knew what they wanted to hear. I'd practically forgotten the language. Some people found it distasteful or confusing if I told them that whatever else, I'd loved it there, too. And if they just asked, what was your scene there? I wouldn't know what to say either, so I'd just say I was trying to write about it and didn't want to dissipate it. But before you could dissipate it, you had to locate it. Information printed on the eye, stored in the brain, coated over skin and transmitted by blood, maybe what they meant by blood consciousness, and transmitted over and over without let-up on increasingly powerful frequencies until you either received it or blocked it out one last time. But he wasn't just some feats-do-your-stuff spade. So when he told me that he saw ghosts whenever they went on night patrol, I didn't laugh. And when he said that he'd started seeing his own out there, I think I freaked a little. We all took a bad flash sooner or later. And usually more than once, like old acid backing up. Certain rock and roll would come in mixed with rapid fire and men screaming. Worst of all, you'd see people walking around whom you'd watch die. The boy with a huge Adam's apple and the wire-rimmed glasses ordering a Coke from a waiter on the Continental Terrace had seemed much more nonchalant as a dead Marine 2 weeks before at the rock pile. I thought for a second I was going to faint when I saw him. After a fast second look, I knew he wasn't a ghost. There actually wasn't much resemblance at all, but by then my breath was gummed up in my throat and my face was cold and white. Nothing to worry about, boy, Paige said. Just your 19th nervous breakdown. They were always telling you shouldn't let yourself think about them too much. You couldn't remain effective as a soldier or a reporter if you fell into patterns of morbid sensitivity. You'll get used to it, people would say. But I never did. Dana used to do a fire-out thing. He'd take pictures of us under fire and give them to us as presents. There's one of me on the ramp of a Chinook at Cam Lo, only the blur of my right foot to show that I'm not totally paralyzed. 27 pushing 50, reaching back for my helmet and the delusion of cover. Behind me, inside the chopper, there's a door gunner in a huge dark helmet. A corpse is laid out on the seat. And in front of me, there's a black Marine staring with raw, raving fear towards the incoming rounds. All four of us caught there while Dana crouched down behind the camera, laughing, I thought you ought to know what you look like, he said. I don't have any pictures of Dana, but there's not much chance I'll forget what he looked like. That frontline face, after 3 years he'd turned into the thing he came to photograph. I have pictures of Sean Flynn, but none by him. He was in so deep he hardly bothered to take them after a while. Definitely off of Media Flynn. A war behind him already where he'd confronted the wasting movie star karma that had burned down his father, Harold. He said that the movies just swallowed you up. So we acted on the ground, and the ground swallowed him up. He and Dana had gone off somewhere together since April 1970, biking into Cambodia. Presumed captured. Those who remember the past are condemned to repeat it too. That's just a little history joke. Shove it along, dissolve your souvenirs, a pair of fatigues that started to fit about a week before I left, an ashtray from the Continental, a National Geographic map of Indochina with about 100 pencil marks, every place I ever went, dots and crosses and big crosses wherever I'd been in or near combat, and my vanity told me I'd pulled through. At midnight over Binh Long, the gunship made 7 or 8 low runs above a company of Viet Cong on the eastern edge of the city. At first, the tracers just snapped away into the dark. Then flares showed a lot of men running out in the open. By 4, half the city was on fire. Reporters weren't allowed on gunships, but this was the second night of the Tet Offensive, total hysteria and no rules. I never got to ride in one of them again. Once I was in a chopper that took a hit and dropped about 300 feet until the pilot pumped his pedals into auto-rotate, restoring us to the air. Dragging back to base camp, we passed over 3 ships shot down close together, 2 of them completely smashed, and the 3rd almost intact, surrounded by the bodies of the crew and the brigade commander, all killed after they reached the ground. Later that day, I went out on a joy pop in a loach with a cab star flyer. We flew fast and close to the ground. Then we came to the river where it ran through a twisting ravine, and he flew the river, taking us through the blind turns like a master. When we cleared the ravine, he sped straight towards the jungle, dipping where I'd been sure he would rise. I couldn't move. That dude can fly him right up his own ass, someone said back at the landing zone. And the pilot came over and said, too bad we didn't get shot at. I'd have liked to shown you my evade. In the Special Forces A camp at Mae Phuc Thay, there was a sign that read, if you kill for money, you're a mercenary. If you kill for pleasure, you're a sadist. If you kill for both, you're a Green Beret. There were great sounds at Mae Phuc Thay. The commander dug the stones. There was only one song from Wei. We gotta get out of this place if it's the last thing we ever do. There were no sounds at all on the road out of Cam Tho. 20 of us in a straight line that suddenly ballooned out into a curve, a wide berth around a Vietnamese man who stood without a word and held his dead baby out to us. We made tracks, and we made dust in our tracks. I swore to God I'd get out soonest. All it took was 8 more months. Out on the street, I couldn't tell the Vietnam veterans from the rock and roll veterans. The 60s had made so many casualties, its war and its music had run power off the same circuit for so long, they didn't even have to fuse. The war primed you for lame years, while rock and roll turned more lurid and dangerous than bullfighting. Rock stars started falling like second lieutenants, ecstasy and death and, of course, life, but it didn't seem so then. What I'd thought of as two obsessions were really only one. I don't know how to tell you how complicated that made my life. Freezing and burning and going down again in the sucking mud of the culture. Hold on tight and move real slow. That December, I got a Christmas card from a Marine I'd known in Way. It showed a psychotic Art Snoopy in battered jungle fatigues, a cigarette clenched in his teeth, blasting away with an M16. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men, it read, and best wishes for a happy 1-9-6-9. Maybe it was classic. Maybe it was my 20s I was missing, not the 60s. But I began missing them both before either had really been played out. The year had been so hot that I think it shorted out the whole decade. It wasn't just that I was growing older, I was leaking time. Like I'd taken a fragment from one of those anti-personnel weapons we had that were so small they could kill a man and never show up on X-rays. Hemingway once described the glimpse he'd had of his soul after being wounded. It looked like a fine white handkerchief drawing out of his body, floating away and then returning. What floated out of me was more like a huge gray chute. I hung there for a long time, waiting for it to open, or not. My life and my death got mixed up with their lives and deaths, doing the survivor shuffle between the two, testing the pull of each and not wanting either very much. I was once in such a bad head about it that I thought the dead had only been spared a great deal of pain. Debriefed by dreams, friends coming in from the other side to see that I was still alive. Sometimes they looked 500 years old, and sometimes they looked exactly as I'd known them, but standing in a strange light, the light told the story, and it didn't end like any war story I'd ever imagined. If you can't find your courage in a war, you have to keep looking for it anyway, and not in another war either. The war ended, and then it really ended. The cities fell. I watched the choppers I'd loved dropping into the South China Sea as their Vietnamese pilots jumped clear, and one last chopper revved it up, lifted off, and flew out of my chest. I saw a picture of a North Vietnamese soldier sitting in the same spot on the Da Nang River where the press center had been, where we'd sat smoking and joking and going too much and far out. And oh my God, it gets so freaky out there. He looked so unbelievably peaceful. I knew that somewhere that night, and every night, there'd be people sitting together over there talking about the bad old days of Jubilee, and that one of them would remember and say, yes, never mind, there were some nice ones too. And no moves left for me at all, but to write down some few last words and make the dispersion Vietnam, Vietnam, Vietnam. We've all been there.
David Soul has been reading Michael Herr's Dispatches. The programme was abridged and produced for Radio 4 by Jane Marshall Productions.